All right, if you have your Bibles then, I'd ask you to turn to the book of 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, and we're going to begin reading in verse 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, and we're going to begin reading in verse 11. The Bible says, "Finally, brethren, farewell. Be perfect. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace.
Amen.
And the God of love and peace shall be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints salute you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen." Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the watch care that you provide this church. Lord, we pray and place the spiritual needs of this group before you, Lord. And we know there are many. Lord, we know that encouragement is a rare item in the day in which we live. We pray for our country, even the events that just transpired in the last few hours, those that have been shot, Lord. God, help them, Lord, that they might somehow see you in this. For the lost that meet with us, God, this would be the day of salvation, that you begin to draw them to yourself and continue a great work in their life. We pray for every outreach that our church has developed, Lord, that you might be with it, that you might draw them into yourself. God, bless your word this evening to the hearts of the hearers, and we'd be faithful to give you the praise for it. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now, I'll be preaching tonight on some words found in the 14th verse concerning true communion with the Holy Ghost. Now, usually 99% of the time when you think about communion, most people immediately think about the Lord's Supper and the Lord's table and observance of the Lord's Supper. That is a use of the word in the King James Bible, but that ain't the only communion that we're to have. In fact, that communion just means we're in agreement with one another and in agreement with the Lord. That's part of why we take time to do that. But I want to go back to verse 11. And the 2 Corinthian letter, if you'll follow it somewhat carefully, this is the third time he's talked with them. He went there as a missionary, and he preached to them. He sent the scathing letter in 1 Corinthians 1, and then he backs it up with 1 Corinthians 2. And I want you to see he had an understanding of what was going to happen. He said, "Finally, brethren, farewell." Now, he knew he wasn't going to get to speak to them again. Have you ever thought if this was the last opportunity that you had to speak to someone, what was it that you would have to say? Because what he told them had to be very, very important. If he knew, and he was, that he was going to die, and actively, face-to-face, he'd probably never see them again, the ending of the letter had to stick and to stick with them. So he says, "Finally, brethren, farewell." Have you ever thought about the time and the place when you'll bid this old world adieu and you'll be out of here and you'll either be home to be with the Lord Jesus Christ or you'll be in the fiery pits of hell because there is no in between? Have you ever thought about that time could be tonight? Have you ever thought about that time could be tomorrow before we meet together again? That eternity might await. You know what? We should begin to think along those lines more and more, because the reason why is not for fearfulness, but it ought to keep our mind on eternal things. See, when we don't keep our mind on eternal things and the reality that eternity is just a wisp away, we become carnally minded. And if you remember, that was this church's problem. Their problems stem from being carnally minded. "Finally, brethren, farewell. Be perfect." Now, in the 2017 mind, that we immediately think of blameless and flawlessness, and exactly right. But no, he was saying, you be complete, you be full. You be completely perfect. Wasn't sinless perfection. Perfect was fullness. Now, most believers today live somewhat empty. You say, well, how do you know that? Well, I see them from the other side of the pulpit every Sunday and every Wednesday night. And listen, people that are full are happy. People that are full are glad. People that are full are enjoying what the Lord's given them. And people that are not, don't. That's pretty simple to understand, isn't it?
Right.
And so we see that the Lord's desire for us, as Paul is conveying it, he wants us to be in this condition of perfection. Not sinless perfection, but fullness. We, if we're saved, we have the ability to be perfectly full. We do. But a lot of times we're not. Be perfect. Be of good comfort. Now, everybody likes to get comfortable. And my family always use this because most people are not comfortable this way. But then when you ask all the kids, because they creep through our bedroom, this is how I go to sleep. They said, Mr. Anglin won't have any problems. I'll be ready to go because I'm already in the right position. That's just comfortable for me. That's a comfortable way for me to sleep. And so that's how I sleep. Now, today the problem is this. Our comfort, we're looking at for other places. We're not getting our comfort from that book. We're not getting our comfort from fellowship with the Lord's people. We're trying to get our comfort from the world. We're trying to get our comfort from the things, the enticements that this world has to offer. If it's through television or music or money or whatever this world may have to offer, our comfort is running from the wrong place. And so when we begin to think of our comfort, don't let things mess you up too much. I mentioned earlier here about this recent shooting where our congressmen were. You know what? That didn't take God by surprise. He wasn't alarmed at it. He knew it was going to happen. And it somehow, in His divine perfect will, it was part of His great plan. And I take comfort in it. You know what? I understand there were several that died. I hate that horrible raging fire in Great Britain. You know what? I hate that. But it did take my God by surprise. And I take good comfort in that. It's encouragement when things are not the way we think they ought to be. So Paul wanted this group to be complete. He wanted it to be perfect. He wanted to be comfortable. And then he says one that's very difficult. Be of one mind. Now I'll give you this. This is not even the sermon. And we're going to continue very hurriedly on because we're going to run out of time. But in regards to a church, to be in one mind, we have to disciple people. You know, me and Don often talk about this. If the Lord, something happened to New Testament church, and I hope it never does, where would you go? I would have to find somewhere where I could be one mind. And if I couldn't, I'd be better off at home, meeting my children. You say, well, it says forsake not the assembly. Well, wherever I go, I'm going to be in one mind. Because you know what? If I'm not, I'm going to be the troublemaker. Be of one mind. And if you can't be of one mind, don't be that, right? And so we see then that that's what Paul's advice to the church of Corinth. You be of one mind. The church be all together on this thing. Live in peace. And that means with the world around them, they're not to be contentious. And the God of love and peace shall be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. Now, nothing wrong with that. The Bible also says to give them the right hand of fellowship. Paul says the same thing in the Thessalonican letter. Nothing wrong with greeting with a holy kiss. I say it's not cultural in the United States culture. I've seen people do it in other cultures. I've visited Mennonite church, and they greeted each other with a holy kiss. Nothing wrong with that. But if that's your culture, be sure it's a holy kiss. You know, it's not. It's to show humility and love. Nothing ungodly about it. Nothing carnal about that holy kiss. And a lot of people said, well, that's just going away. No, it's just not what we think of as an American culture. Verse 13, all the saints salute you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost. Now, if you underline in your Bible that communion of the Holy Ghost is very, very important. It is a missing commodity in the modern day believer's life. And, you know, we talk about fellowship. We talk about fellowship one with another. We talk about fellowship from church to church to church. And, you know what? We don't talk nothing about the communion of the Holy Ghost, do we? And you know why? People get a little uncomfortable at the word Holy Ghost. You know what? It occurs more time in the King James Bible than the Holy Spirit does. So that, and they are the same entity, but I'm just saying, don't you be fearful of using the word Holy Ghost. It's a good Bible term. It has Bible connotations. But here we find that he says there is a communion of the Holy Ghost. And so that means, to me, we can either be in fellowship with him, like we're in communion one with another, or we can be out of fellowship with him. Right? You know what? If you violate the word of God, or violate his command, or if he gives you, if he impresses you through prayer to do a certain thing, and you don't do it, you know what? You've lost communion with the Holy Ghost. That's how it happens. And so Paul's last recommendation for this church at Corinth that had been so troubled, you need communion with the Holy Ghost. You need to spend time alone with the Holy Ghost. You know what? The Lord Jesus Christ is an unbelievable entity, the very Son of the living, mighty God, sitting making intercession for us. But you know what? He's not here. The Holy Ghost is in this dispensation. You know, people say, well, I've seen Jesus. No, you haven't. Number one, the Bible says no man can see God and live. And number two, there are a lot of reasons he told us to keep ourselves from images in Jude, right? Nobody knows what the Lord Jesus Christ looked like. And so this active entity in the here and now has to be the Holy Ghost, does it not? And so that's why he wanted us to have communion, to have fellowship, to have a relationship, to be interactive with the Holy Ghost, because that is the living portion of God that we now deal with. Now, I'll go this even further. If you don't know him, you've probably never been saved. Because the Holy Ghost is what will convict you. The Holy Ghost will make this book more than words on a page and make it the living Word of God. The Holy Ghost will convict you of your sinful condition and your need of salvation. That is the workings of the Holy Ghost. And so we see here that Paul had a very important reason that he wanted them to have communion of the Holy Ghost. And the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen. And so he ended off his letter there. Now, let's go to the Gospel of Matthew very quickly. Matthew chapter number 4. Matthew 4, and we're going to begin reading in verse 18. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 18. The Bible says, "And Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee and saw two brethren, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he saith unto them, Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him." Now, we see some very familiar verses of Scripture, the calling out of Andrew and Peter, and the Lord was specific in that he saw them doing their job and says, "You come and follow me." Now, a lot of people will say, "Well, see, they had a decision to make." Well, the only problem I found with the decision theory, I don't see the Bible documenting anybody that he called that didn't go. Do you? I don't think you'll find that. Now, you'll find some that left later, but everybody he called followed him. Did you know that? every documentation we have that he called somebody, they followed him. And so they get down out of the boat and they go to the Lord Jesus and they're ready to do whatever the master bid them. What a wonderful, wonderful position to be in. Verse 18, and Jesus walking by the Sea of Galilee saw two brethren, a little further down in verse 20, and they straightway left their nets and followed him. And going on from thence, they saw other two brethren, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee their father, mending their nets, and he called them. Now, I want you really to focus in on John, because he was just a boy at this time, about 15 year old. And it said that he went over there and he called them. I believe it's John's gospel said that he actually, they came down and went with him. The calling is everything. Could you imagine seeing the Lord Jesus Christ? I mean, really, have you ever contemplated beholding the person of Christ? Remember what John said? John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world." Can you imagine beholding the person of Christ? And you know what? I don't think we think about that like we should. I mean, literally seeing the Son of God in the flesh while he lived here. What an incredible time to live, to have walked and talked with the person of Christ. Now, you know what? They didn't get it most of the time. And they kind of took it for granted and didn't realize, I think, most of the time, who they were dealing with. But you remember... Remember what the Lord said to Peter? "But whom do ye say that I am?" Matthew 16:16. And he said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." Mm-hmm. See, he's seen for what he was, didn't he? Right. Now, I can't imagine, you know, I really believe it would have been all-encompassing to be around the person of Jesus. And it would have been an incredible thing, an incredible time to be able to look at him and see him and be with him along the way. It must have been a time to live. Turn over a little further, Matthew chapter 10 now. In the first verse, Matthew 10. In the very first verse, the Bible says, and this is after spending a night in prayer, and when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out, and heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. And the names of the 12 apostles are these: the first, Simon, who's called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother. Now, did you get that? This is some years later, probably 18 months later or so. And here we find that little John mentioned again. And he's gotten closer to Jesus. He's in the inner circle now. He's in that very tight fit people of the 12 that he chose out. He's spending time abiding in Jesus. You know what? Those 12 had power the others did not have. You know what? They really did cast out devils. Remember that one time, I believe it was a devil in a young man. And Peter goes, "Why couldn't we cast this one out?" And he said, "Well, this one only goes out by prayer and fasting." See, they had that ability. They had the ability to tread on serpents. They had those apostolic gifts. And certainly John was one of the 12 that was blessed enough to enjoy what he had, and he understood he's moving forward in the service of Christ. Isn't it a sad thing today when you don't see people moving forward in the service of Christ? You see them stagnating. You see them kind of just on the pew where they always are. You never see them moving anything forward in their closeness and their relationship with Christ. You never see them moving anywhere forward and committing themselves more deeply come to the service of Christ, they're just kind of there. You know what? You get a kind of a bunch of just kind of theirs in a church, and you have a dead church before very long.
Amen.
See, John was different than that, wasn't he? You know, John loved Christ so much, he didn't even trust himself. I won't be like that, won't you? I trust Christ a whole lot more than I trust myself. And if you really believe the Word of God, you'd have to say that about yourself as well. Gospel of Matthew chapter 17, just a little further over. We see an unusual event. Now we're down to three. John was called. John became an apostle some year, about 18 months later. And now we're down to three very close-knit folks. Matthew chapter 17, in the first verse, the Bible says, "And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up unto a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as light. And behold, there appeared unto him Moses and Elisha, talking with him. Then answered Peter and said to him, Jesus, Lord, it's good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elisha. And he yet spake, and while he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud, which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And the disciples heard it and fell on their face and were sore afraid." Now, I want you to see, this was an event that only two other people got to see. Because, see, they got to see the Lord Jesus manifested as God. That was an unusual thing. You know what happens to most people that see God? They die. And they got to see the Lord Jesus manifested as God. And old big mouth Peter, let's build some tabernacle. No. Boy, the only thing of significance there was Christ. The only thing was significant there was Christ. And so we find that after it's all over, that John saw some things few men would ever see. John, according to history at least, we don't have Bible for it, but according to history, John is the only apostle that lived to be an old man and died of a natural cause, some say as old as 110 years old, and that he died and was able to share all these things time and time and time again. Now, that seen Christ in a special way. But here in the modern age, this is the problem. Where's Christ at right now, according to the book of Hebrews? He's seated at the right hand of the Father, right? So, even if he was here, we can't see him, right? And even, you know, knowing what the flesh is, if we saw him, we evaluate him with the faculties, with the frailness of this flesh, wouldn't we? And so it's probably a good thing. So if that door is closed, so to speak, what do we see? Who do we know? And it is always the conveyor, the person that brings us to it, is the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. Now, I want to read very quickly in the Gospel of Luke, two places for you. Luke chapter 7. In verse 37, Luke chapter 7, verse 37. "And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment, and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with her tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with ointment. And when the Pharisee saw... which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner." Now, I want you to drop down to verse 44 with me. "And he turned to the woman and said unto him, Simon, seest thou this woman? I I entered into thine house, and thou gavest me no water for my feet. But she washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. Now, very familiar verses of Scripture, and I want you to see that Mary, the sister of Martha, the sister of Lazarus, she was a harlot, a hooker, a woman that made her living by sleeping around with other men. That was her occupation. And she's so captivated by the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, literally. You know what? I dare say most of us couldn't cry enough tears to wash our hands, much less wash someone else's feet. But she did. Most ladies today, their hair ain't long enough to wash anybody's feet. You know, the Bible is very clear about that, don't you? Women don't need hair like this. That's not real popular preaching today, but the Bible is very clear on that. But nonetheless, washed his feet and dried it with the hairs of her head, and she anointed them with oil. And from that day forward, she was never ever the same again. And the thing of it was this, was it says her sins were forgiven. And you know, whenever Lazarus died, Martha questioned, but Mary believed. Mary never questioned the fact of the resurrection of Lazarus. And down at the tomb, we find her again. And he says, Mary. And immediately she knew it was the Lord. And what a wonderful, wonderful thing it was to see the Lord Jesus after the resurrection. You know, I believe if I studied the Bible correctly, he probably was manifested in three different ways. He was in this situation because Mary didn't recognize him. And then he was manifested to the two on the road to Emmaus.
Right.
And then he was manifested to the church. And all in different ways, wasn't it? But you know what? The Lord Jesus, again, sits at the right hand of the Father. He's no longer here. He's no longer in this dispensation. He's at home with the Father, seated at the right hand, even as we speak.
That's right.
So what's left for us? Look with me in the book of Romans. Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5 in the very first verse. Romans 5 in the very first verse. The Bible says, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, peace with God, the great God Jehovah, the sinless entity that always is, that's accomplished through the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. His sacrifice on Calvary, that's how it's accomplished. Verse 2, by whom we also have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Right. And not only so, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience. Now, I'm not going to digress too far on this, but you know what? Most of us do not glory in tribulation. I'll even go a little step further and say most of us don't even know what tribulation's about. Now, if we do, it's come in the form of illness. And it does come that way. If you don't believe me with that, just study in the book of Kings. And it was brought onto more than one king. As Isaiah, before he left the temple, he said, you turn and tell him he's been given 15 more years. Right. See, it does work that way. But you know what? Tribulation can also come in a lot of other ways. At one time, not too many years ago, people were beheaded for defending the truth in this book. And it may happen that way again. Things keep going the way they are. But I want you to see there's a purpose in the tribulations. Knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience. Now, again, if you write in your Bible, you underline that word experience. Because most of us don't have much experience. You know, I'm an experienced nurse. I've been a nurse. In fact, I got my license, I think it will be 23 years ago tomorrow. And I'm an experienced nurse. I can do pretty much anything you need me to do. I wish I was an experienced Christian. You know, you don't gain experience by sitting on these pews. Did you know that? You gain experience right out there. And you know what? I've gained a lot of experience street preaching. That's been good for me. You'd gain a lot of experience in by just striking up conversations with people in the grocery line. That's how you gain experience. And so we see that when these things happen to us, the Lord is doing it for our benefit today to exercise our experience in what He's able to do. Verse 5. And experience hope. If you come through something, when a worse thing happens in a few days, you're going to have hope that God can bring you through it again. Verse 5. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Now remember, we just our text verse says that this communion, that we need to have communion with the Holy Ghost. And here we find, as Paul's writing to the church there at Rome, he says, our love is shed abroad by the Holy Ghost. Have you ever thought about what your actions, what your thoughts might do to the person of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost? You know, Sovereign Grace Baptist people, I've only been around them about less than 20 years, 18 years, something like that. And sometimes there's a lot of self-righteousness there. You know, that don't speak much to this, does it? Shedding love abroad through the Holy Ghost. How did you show love today? How did you convey to someone you're concerned about their soul? How did you convey to someone that you have an interest in their life? How did you share with someone that you're more than just a number to them? See, that happens through the Holy Ghost. We forget that a lot of times, don't we? You know, we as Lord's people need to be very cautious of the things we do. Notice what it says, it's shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Now, again, when the Lord saves a soul, the Holy Ghost comes up and sets His abode up in you. He lives within you. But again, you can offend Him grievously.
Absolutely.
Amen. He's just as much God as the other two portions. He's our active ingredient in the dispensation which we now live. And, it's a very grievous thing to offend the Holy Ghost. And so we see, as the Lord's people, that we need to be very, very mindful of having that communion. Why would you want that? Why would you be desirous of something like that? Well, let me show you something in the book of Acts, chapter 13. And I'll show you the importance of it. Acts 13 in the very first verse. Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets or preachers and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, which was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manamin, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. So you have four brethren that kind of stand out of the ordinary. They were a little bit different. Now, let me say this. First of all, the church at Antioch was a church that meant business with God. Listen, at Antioch, if I got up and preached for 4 hours, there wouldn't even be one single yawn and one little glancing back at the clock. Because they meant business with God. And they were so confident in the person of the Lord and so confident in the person of the Holy Spirit that it meant staying all night. Listen, they were glad and happy and they would stay all night till they heard from God. That was the type of church at Antioch. And out of that wonderful, wonderful church, you had four especially interested brothers in the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ. They weren't Mickey Mouse people. They weren't the routine. They wanted something more. Verse 2. As they ministered to the Lord. Now, when you think of minister, you always think of a preacher, don't you? But when they minister to the Lord, you know, tonight, more than likely, I'll go home and I'll help Joey debate it. That is a type of ministry. Doing something that he can't do for himself. Right? They were ministering to the Lord. In other words, they were interested in putting the Lord first. Ministering to the Lord sometimes means sleepless nights. Ministering to the Lord means praying even when you don't feel like it. Ministry unto the Lord is putting Him in your forethoughts. And you know what? I tried it and found it to be true. If you will do that and you will praise the Lord, even when things are not looking the best, the Lord will bless you and He will show up. That's the type of men these were. They weren't looking for a mission assignment. They weren't looking for a new church to start. They were just serving Christ and serving Him at the church in Antioch. They were doing what God would have them to do. They were ministering unto the Lord. Now notice what happens. And they ministered to the Lord and fasted. The Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." The Holy Ghost told them what to do. You know why people don't speak much of the Holy Ghost anymore? I'll tell you why. They haven't heard from Him. How can you speak of someone you haven't heard from? Right? How can you speak of someone you don't know? Right? So I think maybe the reason we kind of step around the Holy Spirit in Baptist churches if we can, a lot of people don't know it. You know what? I rejoice. And listen, I'm not talking about flopping on the floor and foaming at the mouth. But I'm rejoicing when the Holy Ghost comes my way. And that still small voice, He comes and manifests Himself to me. And I know that I've had more than just a little routine prayer. I've had more than just opening my Bible and reading words on an empty page. I know that I have met with the Lord God. Listen, I praise His name for it because that is what makes the difference. So the Holy Ghost said, "I want these two to do the work that I have called them unto." And you know what? Immediately you have obedience. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So being sent forth by the Holy Ghost. Very important to a ministry, is it not? You know, I believe in church authority, and I believe the man of God should preach under the authority of a church. But I also believe this. I want to be sure that it's God-inspired and not man's idea. Don't you? That's the Holy Ghost. You know, we ought to be able to rejoice. And there is probably not one person under the sound of my voice that hasn't contemplated quitting. Just forget about it. I'm done. I would be lying to you if I told you that I had not thought that. I would be lying if there were days that I have not thought, what am I doing? October the 15th, and I do remember that day, I was preaching the gospel for 23 years. And there's been days I really thought about, what am I doing? Well, and you talk about a lot of time and effort. It's more than anybody ever contemplates until they begin preaching the gospel. You know, I'll never forget this. trying to think. I think I was probably going over in the edge of Kentucky and preaching. I used to know the name of the church. It's not there no more. Any rate, Burma. You wouldn't be there. Burma Baptist Church. And I preached a few times. I was going to Burma to preach. And, I was going to do a call, and they didn't call me. I just say, well, that's the Lord. But I began probably the very first, I was praying with all the kids in McDonald's already in bed. I lay there, and it hit me, the gravity and the seriousness of carrying the gospel somewhere else. Just carrying across the street. And so if we don't have the leadership of the Holy Ghost, what else do you have? And these men had it. They knew what God would have them to do. They understood the gravity of the situation, and they enjoyed the person of the Holy Spirit. Now, in the modern day, we have this. We have routine. We have come to church, do this, this, and this, and then be dismissed. Then do this, this, X, Y, Z, and do this. The only problem is, there's none of that in the Bible whatsoever. What's wrong with just simply being led by the Holy Ghost? Being led by the Holy Spirit into what we are to do as a people together. You know what? We need to hear from God. And you're going to do it in two methods. And they combined up like this. You're going to get it through that book. And mingled with the Holy Ghost. Because see, there's been way many two times that I've got in that book. And it's just like reading through a Sears and Roebuck. Sure. But then, every once in a while, you go through there, and as the Bible says of itself, it becomes a living word. And things that you've read a thousand times suddenly just open up. And see, we need the Holy Ghost. We need the Holy Ghost to convict people of their sins. We need the Holy Ghost to inspire people to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We need the Holy Ghost. Desperately. You want encouragement in the last days? That's where you get it. From that book and from the Holy Ghost.